part four, Invasion of the Body Snatchers. And we're going to be talking today about a ghost invasion. Kind of appropriate seeing that Halloween is just a couple of days away, right? And we had a great event yesterday with a lot of ghosts and ghouls and goblins walking on our premises as we try to take care of 616 individuals. But we're going to focus on 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, and then 9 through 14. The Apostle Paul is writing these words. Listen carefully to what he has to say. When I first came to you, dear brothers and sisters, I didn't use lofty words and impressive wisdom to tell you God's secret plan. For I decided that while I was with you, I'd forget everything except Jesus Christ and the one who was crucified. Isn't that great news for all of us? Sometimes we try to almost outdo ourselves, and we try to become more intelligent or appear that way, when the best we can do is hang our hat on Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness, timid, and trembling, and my message and my preaching were very plain. Rather than using clever and persuasive speeches, I relied only on the power of the Holy Spirit. I did this so you would trust not in human wisdom, but in the power of God. That is what the scriptures mean when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love Him. But it was to us that God revealed these things by His Spirit. For His Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. And we have received God's Spirit, not the world's Spirit, so we can know the wonderful things God has freely given us. When we tell you these things, we do not use words that come from human wisdom. Instead, we speak with words given to us by the Spirit, using the Spirit's words to explain spiritual truths. But people who aren't spiritual can't receive these truths from God's Spirit. It all sounds foolish to them, and they can't understand it. For those who are spiritual can understand what the Spirit means. Well, up to this point, we have talked about Satan's invasion, how he has come, and his whole purpose is to enslave us. But actually, he even goes deeper than that. Satan's purpose is to destroy us. Then we'll talk about Christ's invasion. His purpose was to save us, redeem us, transform us. Last week, we looked at faith invasion. True faith, genuine faith, inspires us. It motivates us to do God's bidding. Actually, James says that by our works, people will know that we're believers. They'll know that our faith is indeed active. But today, we're going to wrap up our series by looking at ghost invasion. How the Holy Ghost empowers us to do God's will. But before we get into all of that, I need to show you that I have here an iPhone 8. I know you're jealous. You're looking at me with envy right now. You're probably saying, on a pastor's salary, how does he constantly do this? Well, the truth of the matter is, I'm in a program where every year I can upgrade, and it costs me little to nothing. So I upgraded to the iPhone 8. Now, this iPhone, the 8, however, has the newest technology. It has 21st century cutting edge technology, which I really don't know much about because I don't know how to use it all. That's another true statement. So with all this said, let me ask, how do you remember the very first cell phone that ever came out? The old bag cell phone. I'll show you a picture of it right now. Man, can you imagine carrying that thing around with you? And if you happen to ever own an old bag cell phone, mind you, it costs $950 a minute to operate. So, would you rather have still the old bag cell phone or the smartphone? Hopefully it's smart now, right? Okay. Some of you probably put your hands, I still want the old. I want the old bag cell phone. Well, you may be saying, okay, Pastor, you showed us back to an old concept of the ministry and power of the Holy Spirit. They view the Holy Spirit more like an iPhone app or an accessory. I got all kinds of apps here. I don't know why I put on my phone, but I have apps for every occasion. And some think that perhaps the Holy Spirit's just an app. You press it when you want to use it. It's an add-on. It's really not much more than any of that. When in reality, the Holy Spirit needs to be the internal operating system. The Holy Spirit is not an accessory. It's the spiritual engine by which we operate. And the Holy Spirit also, I hope I don't raise a lot of eyebrows with this, but the Holy Spirit is not goosebumps that you feel on certain occasions. It's not an emotional buzz that you get when a song is sung or a message is preached. Somebody says, I've never got a buzz when you preach the message, Pastor. However, before you mistake what I'm saying, I pray that there's times that your emotion is stirred through a song, and I pray there's times that a message sometimes, you know, gets you to think differently. The Holy Spirit prompts those feelings, but the Holy Spirit's not that feeling. The Holy Spirit is God in you. It's not those feelings. Because if it was those feelings, how many of you ever had goosebumps over a secular song? Yeah, you've had that, right? How about before you got saved, you listened to certain songs, and they kind of slayed you, like the Beatles or whatever, if you went to a concert. So my question would be simply this: where is the Spirit when we're not in church, listening to a song or hearing a message? I pray the Spirit still speaks to you. I pray the Spirit still comes alongside and gives you wisdom and guidance, that the Holy Spirit still moves you. The second thing you need to know, the Holy Spirit is not like gasoline that fuels a car. It's not like you can just simply go up to the gas pump when you're running low and kind of plug in and pump the Holy Spirit into you or ask the attendant for a fill-up. The Holy Spirit is more like the air we breathe. We need God's Spirit every moment of every day to actually function and survive as a Christian. I think Michael W. Smith, when he wrote the following lyrics, had this kind of thought in mind. He wrote these words: this is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence is living in me. This is my daily breath. This is my daily bread, your very words spoken to me. I'm desperate for you. I'm lost without you. See, Michael W. Smith is saying the Holy Spirit is the engine, the air that gives us life. So listen, people, whether you realize it or not, there is an iOS update. Not iOS 11, but there's an update. It comes from Acts 1:8. But you receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses, telling people everywhere about you, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Did you catch what is written there? When the Holy Spirit comes upon us, it will give us the power to be God's witness in our home, in our neighborhood, in our community, in our cities and towns, and even throughout the world. It's the Spirit that empowers us to do what? To preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's what the Apostle Paul said is the main thing. Now I'm going to ask another question. How many here in this room remember the old TV show Beverly Hillbillies? Okay. Now I'm finally ringing a bell. Now, I woke you all up. Well, in the Beverly Hillbillies, you understand the whole premise is old Jed Clapper's out hunting. And I wish Jim was here, because Jed was not a good hunter. I dare say he probably would have been like me out hunting. Jim does not trust me with a gun, a rifle, or anything that might hurt someone. Because Jed's out there hunting, misses everything. except the ground. But because he hits the ground, what comes out? Oil. And overnight, he is a millionaire. Oil's on his property, he's a millionaire, and then he does the dumbest thing ever. He moves to California. But let's just take that out of the picture, and now he's in California. Question I have to ask, how long was the oil on his property? Forever. He was always a millionaire, but he didn't know it. He always had the resources right there, but he wasn't aware of it until that day he went out hunting and accidentally shot the ground and oil came up. I think too many of us treat the Holy Spirit like I treat my iPhone 8. It has so much potential that we're not even tapping into it. God's Spirit living in us, and what are we doing with it? It almost seems like we put it to the side and kind of put in its own little category or its own little room and let it out just periodically. We're only using a portion of the potential afforded us through God's Spirit. In Exodus 32, a story is told of Moses as he's receiving the Old Covenant, the law. He goes up into the mountain, receives the Ten Commandments. But while he's up there, the people get restless. You pretty much know much of the story. And they rebel against God, they rebel against Moses. By the time Moses comes down off the mountain, I mean, there's all kinds of chaos. During that process, 3,000 people were destroyed because of the rebellion against God. However, in the second chapter of Acts, we find Peter, who is now filled with the Holy Spirit, preaching the new covenant. Jesus Christ has been crucified, and in verse 41, we discover that 3,000 find new life in Christ. You see, if you want to carry around that old bad cell phone, it's going to wear you out. If you're trying to keep the old covenant, the old way of thinking, it's going to put a heavy burden on you. But when you receive Jesus Christ and allow his Spirit to flow through you, it is life. It is real life. The old covenant brought death, whereas the new covenant brings life. So in the moments we have left, let's take a closer look at the purpose and ministry of the Holy Spirit from our text in Corinthians that we read together today. First of all, I want you to know how the world responds to God's Spirit. And we note that in verse 14, it says, people who aren't spiritual can't receive these truths from God's Spirit. It all sounds foolish to them, and they can't understand it. For only those who are spiritual can understand what the Spirit means. Well, there are three ways in which the world responds to God's Spirit. First is they resist it. They just can't understand it. They don't understand what it's all about, and so they're going to resist it. Have you found when you open up and talk to people about Jesus Christ that there's a slew of responses and attitudes? Now, there's one thing I want to make note. When I share Jesus Christ with anyone, whether it be my family, whether it be people I run into, I share Jesus Christ not because I'm trying to force my theology upon them, nor my religion upon them. I share Jesus Christ because I love them enough, I don't want them to miss God's best for their life. And I hope that's why you share Jesus. Even though there's a resistance out there, that you're sharing Jesus because you actually love these people. And you care for them, and you don't want them to miss eternity with our Lord. But the Spirit's resisted by the natural world. Also, the Spirit is ridiculed. It all sounds foolish to them. And so they may make comments about your faith, ridiculing your God, ridiculing who you are because of your belief system. That's okay. The Bible says that's the way the world's going to respond. And then the Spirit is misunderstood. Now, I challenge the first service because I have resisted, ridiculed, and I couldn't come up with an R for misunderstood. And so I told him, you need to help me. Nobody helped me, so we still got misunderstood. Couldn't think of an R for that. But you know, it says that the natural world just can't comprehend it as you're sharing Christ. Understand that there may be some things that you're going to have to help explain even in greater detail. But what can we know about the Holy Spirit? Well, to put it very simply, is that the Holy Spirit is God. Yeah. It's God in us. We even sang this morning about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We believe in the Trinity, the three in one. And if we need proof, go back and reread the text that we had for the day. You see, the words God and Spirit are interchangeable, or one in the same. For example, in verses 4 and 5, we see that the Spirit's power is also God's power. In verse 11, we see that the very thoughts of God are also the very thoughts of the Spirit. And another thing I want you to understand, the Spirit is not impersonal. The Spirit speaks to us. It's still God's small voice trying to help us understand His desires. Verses 9 and 10, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love Him. But it goes on to say, but God has revealed it by His Spirit. He reveals truth to us through His Spirit. According to verse 10, the Holy Spirit searches all things. According to verse 11, the Holy Spirit knows the thoughts of God. And that's why you and I need to hold on to the Spirit, right? Because it brings those thoughts into our life. And then the Holy Spirit teaches us God's wisdom and God's truth. In verse 13, it says, this is what we speak, not in words taught us by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, expressing spiritual truths in spiritual words. But guess what, folks? Along all those lines, one of the greater purposes of the Holy Spirit, greatest desire of the Spirit, is to be active in your life. Not to be stagnant, not to be pressed down, but to be alive. The Holy Spirit's purpose is to empower us to share our testimony. The Apostle Paul said, I didn't come with eloquence or superior wisdom. I simply came with a testimony that reveals what God's done in my life. He said, I don't want to know anything except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. He said, I came to you before you in weakness and fear and much trembling. Hey, this is the Apostle Paul speaking. You know, I shared with you before my very first sermon, didn't I? I was taught that when you preach, everything had to be 3 points. So I decided I'd do Zacchaeus. And my very first sermon was Zacchaeus was a wee little man. So am I. Zacchaeus was up a tree. So am I. Zacchaeus got down. So am I. And then I made my way off the platform. Because my teeth were chattering, God bless America, my knees were knocking home sweet home, and I really wished I was scared. It was a tough experience preaching your very first message. Still tough even today. But Paul says, I came with all those things wrestling in my own heart. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words. But then he concludes with this. It was the demonstration of God's Spirit within me. Unlikely as it may seem, the Apostle Paul experienced all the same difficulties we face when it comes to sharing our faith with others. Verse 1 tells us Paul did not come with eloquent words, with superior wisdom. In verse 3, he confesses that he came to them in weakness, fear, and trembling. In verse 4, reminding us also what he said in verse 1, my message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words. In other words, Paul says, I can identify with every excuse you have ever used not to share the gospel. I've been down that road. But guess what, my friends? It's because you and I are not qualified that God has given us His Spirit to empower us, to give us the strength to do what we need to do. The focal point, the Holy Spirit's purpose is to empower you and I to express the gospel of Jesus Christ. John 16:8 says this, and when He, that being God's Spirit, comes, He'll convince the world of its sin, and of God's righteousness and of the coming judgment. You know, throughout my years of ministry, there have been people that have told me that they just don't sense enough of the Holy Spirit in our services because of the fact that there's not certain gifts that are displayed during the worship service. Now, oftentimes when they come into my office and begin to express their concern, I'm almost shell-shocked to the point I can't even answer, you know, with any kind of intelligence. But let me just share something with you that might help to some degree if you're ever feeling that way. My wife and I have served with you folks for 8.5 years, or a little over 8.5 years. Do you know that in those 8.5 years, through all the ministries of Riverside Blessing, not just worship service, but all the ministries that we've done, over 300 people have received Jesus Christ as personal Savior.
Amen.
Now let me go back and ask another question. What is the purpose of the Holy Spirit? To convince people of Jesus Christ. To draw people to Jesus Christ. So when people say the Holy Spirit's not here, I beg to differ. The Holy Spirit's here in a powerful way. God is doing a work that only God can do. I can't do it. You can't do it. But in and through us, the Spirit enables it to happen. And we're seeing wonderful things happening. So congregation, do not let others tell you that you're lacking spiritually because you don't possess certain gifts. Don't let them convince you that you're missing out on having the full power of God. And you've heard this before. It doesn't just fall from my lips. Be very careful who you allow to speak into your life. Because when Jesus came into your heart and life, he brought everything with him on that first trip. And that means he brought the Holy Spirit also. You are complete in Christ. And Colossians 2:10 affirms that. And let me just wrap up with this before we have the praise team come. You know, there are a lot of things that happen in ministry that are humorous. When my wife and I were pastoring in Arkansas, there were three people in our church that had actually come out of prison. And while they were in prison, they found Jesus Christ. Beautiful thing. But also, while they were in prison, all three of them pursued ministry online. So they had no real study. They just went online and tried to get a license to preach or a paper that says they were ordained. The problem with that is all three would come up to me on different occasions telling me that I was not minding God. That I was not paying attention to God. I was missing out on what God had in store for the church because on any given Sunday, it was their Sunday to preach. Now, I want to say, if it was your Sunday to preach, don't you think God would have told me? Instead of allowing me to work all week long on the message that I thought he was giving me to preach? But that was what they would come up with. But it even went beyond that. There were some that would come into my office, and not only talk about their gift of preaching and that I should surrender the pulpit to them, but they would say that because Jesus Christ would appear anywhere, anytime, especially in the upper room, that he had the ability to literally, as a ghost, go through things. And if Jesus can do it, they can do it. And I thought at first they were just being silly. No, they weren't. They were talking about, I mean, they got even into chemistry on how this all can happen when they go through solid doors and everything else. Well, after so much of that conversation, you know, here's how I wanted to respond to the three stooges. I didn't. But how I wanted to respond to them is, hey guys, I got caller ID and you're not gone. Oh. My friends, if God speaks and we're allowing the Holy Spirit to work within us and in us, don't you think he'll talk directly to you? His voice will become evident in you. So I'm going to ask the praise team if they come to the platform. Because what we really need to lay hold of is the Holy Spirit gives us power to be bold in our faith. Power to be courageous in our testimony. But also, if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, maybe as we're going through these moments together, you felt a tugging at your heart. That's the Holy Spirit as well. Tugging at your heart to repent and receive God's gift of grace. So we're going to stand together as we close the same song. And maybe God has just spoken to you. You want to come and make a covenant, a renewed covenant.